Miss March! Another letter has arrived for you, Miss March!
Mrs. Kirk! The man you ordered is on the kitchen table! Thank you, Professor! Oh, Christopher Columbus, another publisher! Another rejection?
I have no idea. I do not read your letters, but they keep arriving and I keep bringing them to you.
And I keep hoping.
We all keep hoping for your success, Miss March. The entire boarding house keeps hoping. You have us all on edge.
My dear Miss March, I read your story. Well, he's read it. Unfortunately, I found your tale tasteless and vulgar, not at all suitable for my kind of readers. My advice to you would be to...
My advice to you is to return home and have babies. This is what women are made for. Sincerely, F. Putnam.
22.
22?
22 rejections since I've been in New York, and they all say the same thing. Go home, give up.
F. Putnam is an idiot. His words are stupid.
F. Putnam is one of the most powerful publishers in the entire city.
You cannot lose faith, Miss Marks. There will be someone who would like your story. I'm certain of it.
Professor Bear, might I possibly read my story to you? I would so respect your opinion.
Yes, of course.
Oh, actually, it's one of my best. It's a mean and stormy night. The moors are bleak and bloody. Lightning strikes, thunder claps. The fair Clarissa, her clothes in disarray, races across the wild coastal heath. And now she stops. And now she runs. Will she escape? Will she? Because with bold determination, the villainous aristocrat, Braxton Pendergast, lurches for her! There's no escape. She's but a child. And yet she turns to fight with eyes ablaze. This noble girl meets his gaze and afraid. She will not be defiled. Keep away from me, you wretch!
I cannot keep away.
Your beauty draws me. Your passion ignites me.
I've got to hold you.
I defy you.
I've got to have you.
Let me buy you.
Come close.
So close
to me. I'll have her and the mother too.
And then Rodrigo appears in magnificent splendor.
I'll have that woman, villain.
Who are you?
I am your destiny, your bitterest foe. You stole what was rightly mine 10 long years ago. Left me cold, alone, and forgotten. Now I'm back to settle the score.
March! Tell me, what is it you're writing here?
Blood and gut stuff. The magazines and periodicals are just full of it.
Violence and seduction on every page.
Read Shakespeare, read history, read the newspapers.
It is getting late. Perhaps we best pursue this some other time.
No, no! I want to know what you think, Professor.
Blood and gut stuff. What she thinks the world wants to hear. If I have noticed nothing else about you, Miss March, I have noticed you are unique. Something you should try not to forget. I think you can do better.
Better? And who are you anyway? An aging German professor close to 50? Who has no... 34, really? You look a lot older.
I worry a lot.
And just what do you worry about?
How to avoid a conversation such as this. Now I'm going to... Miss March, since you have been here 6 weeks now, is it? You shout, you rant, you upset the entire order of this boarding house. I am a serene and peaceful man.
You are aloof, you're arrogant!
And Miss March, I spoke my mind as you spoke yours! Obviously, it was not appreciated on either side!
Obviously! My stories were a great success in Concord! Better! Better than what? Better than this dazzling plot! Better! The story will be my King Lear! Each page is better! Better than him! Better! Even my smallest whim is better! true. If I don't succeed, what will I do? Turn around, go back to Concord, leave New York behind unconquered? No! How dare you make me doubt the way I feel? Doubt that each thrilling page is who I am. Are these words alive with passion? Vivid as my attic, where it all began.
Joe! Joe! The girls were terrible to me in school. They said that my dress was ragged and my nose was flat.
Joe, I hate being a governess. I should be out meeting eligible young men.
It's going to be a dismal Christmas. What with father away and no money for presents.
Meg, Amy, Joe has a surprise for us. Or was I better when I was home? Listen up, everyone! I have risen to the occasion this year and written us an operatic tragedy.
And you're going to perform it for Christmas?
No, I can't. Not with my flat nose.
Joe, do you really think we should? But with this awful war and father gone.
When have we ever let anything defeat us? Years from now, people will talk about us. One Christmas Eve, four penniless and ragged sisters put on an operatic tragedy for all of Concord.
All of Concord!
Filled with blood and guts! Two massacres, a mass ball, and several heart-wrenching scenes. We'll dim the lights, the crowd will hush. We'll start the overture and Beth will surely blush. And when Clarissa starts to bleed, Christmas will exceed our finest dreams.
Joe, do I die again in this one?
Yes! Maggie will die like none before! The world will shatter when your body hits the floor! For when Rodrigo makes you bleed, Christmas will exceed our finest dreams. Oh, now Amy, as Clarissa, only passion is permissible. This tragedy depends upon the fire in your eyes. And then when you're the mother, you'll be noble, you'll be pure. All hearts will melt the moment mother cries. Let us begin.
Oh!
Mother, dear mother, do not cry.
No, 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 Amy. Expression, passion from the heart. Mother! Oh, dear mother, do not cry.
Mother, oh no, dear. Joe, I'm teased and ridiculed at school, and all that you care about is your silly little tragedy.
I know you're tired. I know it's hard. Do you triumph when Rodrigo yells,
Unshamed!
Jesse's guaranteed. Christmas will be thrilling. Christmas will be gory. Christmas will exceed our finest. I made an important decision today. As you all know, I've been writing stories forever, and with much satisfaction. And people seem to like what I write.
You love it, Joe.
Absolutely. So I've decided I'm going to become a world-renowned writer. I will write great books and earn barrels of money. And I will give you all everything that you've ever dreamed of.
Oh, Joe.
For the best. But we must promise to remain just as we are, solid, like a fortress. So that no matter whatever happens, we will always be
four March sisters
forever!
Forever!
Come, let's rehearse!
Oh, mother, not dear mother, don't you
cry! You have me!
What?
Oh, no one!
Oh, my God!
We've got my boots and
I'm not afraid. to bring Father home.
I will write a letter to President Lincoln tonight, another.
I want you to get Annie Moffat to invite me to her St. Valentine's Day ball.
And I'll wring her bloody little neck if she doesn't.
Another.
I want you to bring us a Christmas tree.
Rodrigo will chop one down immediately.
But where?
There, across the road.
But that's Mr. Lawrence's property.
They'll go to prison for it.
Prison? What care I?
Joe is an incredible human being.
Oh, look, it's Mr. Lawrence.
Oh, look,
he's standing at his window glaring out.
He looks sinister.
I think he looks sad.
I wouldn't be sad living in such a house.
Do you think anyone's ever been inside?
He never let any of us in.
They say he's a very angry and bitter man. Oh, Joe's gonna get us into deathly trouble.
All we know is the family with the criminal sister.
What criminal sister?
Marty!
What's happening?
Joe's written an operatic tract.
And she's inviting all the Concord to come and see it.
And I'm the mother in it.
And I die in it. But it's a beautiful day.
And I play Clarissa, who is very sweet.
That sounds wonderful.
Oh, Marmee, it's Joe's best.
Well, tell us about your day.
Well, we knitted socks and blankets for the Soldiers' Aid Society. And a letter came from Father. Well, where's Joe?
She's outside.
Well, we'll wait for Joe.
And she won't be home for hours.
Now, I want to hear everything you did in your day.
Joe has returned!
Joe!
Marty!
Where did you get that tree?
I borrowed it from Mr. Lawrence.
Oh, Joe, you didn't.
I took it for us, Marty.
You'll take it back immediately.
Take it back? It's like taking back a chicken after you've chopped off its head.
Oh, don't let us keep it, Marmee.
It's Christmas, Marmee.
No, destroying someone else's property.
Well, we could give it to the Hummels. They have so little.
Good. The tree goes to the Hummels then.
Ugh.
Now, what about Mr. Lawrence?
What about him?
Mr. Lawrence?
Yes, Mr. Lawrence. You.
Me?
Chop down my perfect Douglas fir! I should have you arrested.
I'll make it up to you, sir.
With what?
I'll plant 6 more.
12.
And I'll chop for firewood for a few days.
Weeks. Yet I should hope such an incident never happens again. You've ruined my day!
He loves his trees. I'm Theodore Lawrence III, but everyone just calls me Laurie. I've come to live with my grandfather here in Concord. I play the piccolo. I can sleep standing up. And I once won a medal at school for holding my breath for 3 whole minutes. Until I passed out. I think it was incredibly daring what you did to grandfather's tree. Good evening.
Wait! Theodore Lawrence III. Would you mind taking that tree to the Hummels?
Joe!
I don't mind.
He doesn't mind.
Just point me in the direction.
1/2 mile down the road, the red house with the broken shingles.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Joe, you must think before you act on every whim.
I just wanted us to have a wonderful Christmas, Marmee.
Oh, we got a letter from Father, Joe.
Oh, where's the Father? Do read the letter, Marmee.
My dear wife, the war goes on and on. The days are difficult and long. The end is nowhere in sight. But I am well.
He's well.
Still, it's lonely here away from my dear ones. Especially lonely as Christmas is approaching. Each night in my tent, I think of my precious girls.
He thinks of us.
Give them all my love and give them each a sweet kiss. Tell them to be good girls, thoughtful and hardworking, and to conquer that which is disagreeable in them. So that when I return, I can be fonder and prouder than ever of my little women. Why are we all looking so glum? Do we have an operatic tragedy to perform or not?
We do.
Good, then we have work to do. We have costumes to complete, and we'll need an oleo curtain for you to paint.
Oh, and will you perform something with us, Mari?
Oh, do, Mari. I'll write something for you with passion and daring.
Yes, yes, I will. We will make this the best Christmas ever. We March women are invincible. Come, let's get to work.
Oh, I'll get my paint. And I'll make a costume for Mari.
I still don't know why we couldn't have kept the tree.
Dear husband. Write a letter, be inventive. Tell you everything is fine. Be attentive to the distance. Send my love with every line. Every word should bring you closer and caress you with its tone. Nothing should remind you that I am here alone. What I'm feeling, I can't talk about the war, how the pealing of the church bells brings the battle to our door. I don't know which part is harder, what I know. I am here alone, counting days, praying for news. Is this the life we meant to choose? Do you know how much I miss you at this hour of the day? How I wish you were the twilight, come to take my fears away. Can I manage for young women? I'm not certain I know how. That I could bring you home.
bring you this beautiful flower.
Don't trifle with me, Josephine! You were dawdling!
I was not dawdling. I was writing a story.
You are what happens to a girl when she has no father.
I have a father.
Never there when you need him. And my nephew has the audacity to go off and become an army chaplain when he can't even support his own family. Listen to me, Josephine. You are on the verge of womanhood.
Christopher Columbus.
And just look at you. You go about writing these silly stories, trying to save the world, when you can't even save yourself.
I don't need saving.
There are many pitfalls a girl can fall into, Josephine. And you are headed for all of them. I want to see you shine. Even if you're not rich, at least you can marry well.
Oh, I'll never marry.
You'll marry. All girls marry.
I'm not all girls.
With a good marriage, you can have power. You can take your place in society.
I don't give two figs about society.
Well then, there is no point in us even having this conversation. It is clear to me I could never take you to Europe.
Take me to Europe?
It was an idle thought of mine.
Do you have any idea how important it is for a writer to travel? Oh, it's been my dream, Aunt Mart.
We earn our dreams in this world, Josephine. It was foolish of me to think you could ever change your ways.
I could try.
Oh, you could never bend your will. You could never follow through. You could never bite your tongue, though your tongue is split in two. If you want to live your dreams, these are things you have to do. How could you change? You can't! Not you!
I could change if I wanted to.
Could you practice self-control? Could you possibly be shy? Could you wear a corset tight in the heat of mid-July? These are rules you must obey, every one which you defy will never change. You won't, that's why. Yet somewhere deep within my heart, I do believe you could captivate the world. Change. There is so much you could achieve. In time you would succeed and travel very far indeed. You could be beguiling,
charming me,
someone well mannered, a model of grace. Learn the art of smiling.
That could be hard.
It is very hard for someone full of dreams like you. If you work, you'll find there's nothing you can't do.
So if I change, we'll go to Paris.
Change completely or don't waste my time.
If I change, we'll stop in Antwerp.
Gracious living will make you sublime.
If I change, you'll take me to Zurich.
Every city from Dublin to Cork.
Surely, with your guidance, I could learn to use feminine wiles with delight. I would be beguiling. Learn to charm a donkey for a chance to see the world. Learn the art of smiling.
Do is work to acquire any skill. These are things a girl
must do, but she has a dream she must fulfill.
She tell you what? She tell you took? She tell you think? She tell you all?
I hold my breath and hold my tongue, do what it takes to travel far.
Could you?
Mine. I know. All it needs is a pretty sash. And besides, why shouldn't I go?
Because you weren't invited.
Well, I can go in your place.
In my place?
Amy!
Well, you don't care about good society, and I do.
I don't care about snobs. People who think that they're better than you just because they have grander houses.
Well, they do have grander houses.
Amy, that's enough.
Well, I want elegance and fine things, Marmee.
And I want passion. I want to be noticed because I'm unique, not because of some silly...
Sashes aren't silly. On March, the right accessories are a key to a girl's success. And besides, I wouldn't go to a ball with scorch marks on the back of my dress.
What?
As big as yours.
Amy, that's enough. Beth, please get my sewing box.
Well, Jo hates balls. She should stay in her musty old attic and write her silly little story.
My stories aren't silly.
Well, nobody reads them, and nobody likes them.
Well, I like them. I'm sending one off to a very prominent New York publisher.
And he'll hate it.
Amy, that's enough. Jo, it's barely noticeable.
We must go.
Yes, and I'll tell everyone how sweet you were to give me your beautiful fan. Good night, Beth, Marmee. If anyone asks for us, we're at the ball.
Good night, everyone.
Have a wonderful evening, girls. Amy, I want you to think about what you said. And when Jo comes home, I want you to apologize. Now come get ready for bed.
Sisters from across the way. This is Meg, right?
Yes.
And this is Jo. She chops her firewood on occasion. This is Mr. John Brooke. He's a scholar from Boston.
I'm Laurie's tutor. Come, Laurie.
Oh, sir, you've taken my dance card.
Oh, your dance card? Is this yours? I'm sorry. So... you're Margaret March.
Yes. Yes, I am.
It's a splendid party, isn't it?
Yes, it's quite lovely. So you're from Boston?
Maine, actually.
I've never been to Maine.
Oh, it's a beautiful country. You'd love it. Very primitive.
I love primitive.
Really?
Mr. Brooke is a romantic.
Is that true?
No. I read Sheets and Kelly. I mean Keats and Shelley.
So do I.
You read Keats and Shelley?
All the time.
Christopher Columbus!
Would you like to dance, Miss March?
No, Meg, we were just about to join the ladies in the salon.
I'd be delighted, Mr. Brooke. Excuse us, Joe.
Did Did you see that? He just... What is it with you and that smile?
You make me beam.
Well, you look ridiculous.
Well, I think you look very fetching tonight.
Fetching? Really?
So when you're not attending balls, what do you do?
Well, I write bloody gut stories. I make extraordinary plans. I'm going to Europe. I'm going to meet famous writers and revolutionaries. Oh, sorry. What about you? What do you do? Marmy says that you're all alone in the world. No father or mother. That must be terrible for you.
It's not awful. I have a cranky old grandfather. And I have a cat. And I have...
What?
I was hoping to say, you.
Me? No, no, you don't have me.
I know I have no right, but sometimes late at night, I'll watch you in the attic, pacing back and forth like a maniac. I've never met a girl like you, anyone at all like you. This is very nice. Such a lovely party, the music sounds so thrilling. It makes a person feel like dancing. I'm very good. I won a medal for dancing at school.
I don't dance. Besides, I've got a patch on the back of my dress.
A patch? Let me see.
No, no.
I like it. That patch could start a whole new fashion. You dance with me tonight, and I guarantee by next spring, every girl in Concord will be wearing a patch on her dress. We could do 100 things, do anything we please. We could fly on golden wings across the seven seas. I'll bet we could get a camel through a needle if you'll take a chance on me.
You're a lunatic.
We could catch 1,000 stars and stack them on a pin. We could leap from here to Mars and make the planet spin. If you want to do all the things you've ever dreamed of, come on, take a chance on me. We could be such friends. All I know are books. Books are solitary, but I see you every day. How you live in your own way, and you make me wanna dare to take a chance on you.
All right, we can box if you like.
You box?
You ready?
I should warn you. I won a medal for boxing at school.
So tell me, is that how you win medals?
You've seen it. We could live out a million dreams, but only if we dare. Okay, you win, you win, you win. We could go to such extremes. There's so much we could share. We'll circle the world doing all we've ever dreamed of. And we'll live in our own way. And I'll see you every day. We'll be the best of friends.
Come on!
Right.
excuse me, Mrs. March. John Brooke, Lori's tutor. We were dancing. The ankle made me sprain. Thank you. Goodbye. Good night.
Good night.
The evening started out quite strangely, but it ended magnificently. Good evening, Joe.
Good night. Can you walk on it?
Oh, it's nothing, Marmee.
Tell us about the ball. Well, I tried to do all these ladylike things, but they ended up completely unnoticed, except for by Mr. Lawrence's grandson. And then, poor Meg, no one even asked her to dance except that pompous Mr. Brooke.
Oh, he danced divinely. Had a wonderful time. Actually, I had the best time of my life. I may have left here a girl, but I came home a woman.
A woman? Meg, what is she talking about?
It's just Meg being silly, Marmee.
It's been a long day for all of us. It's time to get ready for bed.
Oh, Beth, darling, look what I got for you. A truffle.
Thank you.
Amy?
I'm sorry for the things I said, Joe.
And for you, Miss March, a pettifor, a little squashed, but still edible.
Oh, thank you.
Good night.
Coming, Joe?
In a minute, Marmee. I want to put the finishing touches to my story.
Don't be too long, and see to it that the fire's out.
Amy? Amy? Amy, where are you?
Amy?
Joe, what's wrong?
What did you do to my story?
Nothing, I...
Amy, what did you do? I've been working on that day and night.
I burned it!
You what?
And I'm glad I did.
Amy,
yourself, and I couldn't bear to see that happen. Now try and get some rest.
I can't sleep. I won't.
I will never go to sleep again.
withered.
Before spring comes.
I'll give you a 2-minute head start.
2 minutes?
And still beat you!
Joe doesn't want me.
We'll go anyway.
But she hasn't talked to me in 3 weeks. I tried to write up another thing for what I burned, but I couldn't think of anything to say. So I drew this picture of her with her beautiful, beautiful hair, and she just ignored it. And besides, my skates don't fit me anymore.
Then take mine.
Really? Oh, thank you, Beth. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Oh, I hope one day that I can be as sweet as you.
You are sweet.
Oh.
What were you going?
Sorry, Mr. Lawrence.
The piano sounds terrible.
It needs a tuning, sir.
Where is my grandson, Lori?
I'm sure we'll be home soon.
The boy's missed 6 lessons already, fallen behind in all his work, and I have strictly forbidden him to associate with this family.
Why, sir?
Because a man needs an iron will if he is to succeed in this world, and this family will only soften him. Which one of the dreadful little March girls are you?
I'm Dreadful Beth.
Oh yes, Laurie told me. You're the one that wants to play my priceless piano. It's out of the question. The piano belonged to my daughter, Lori's mother. It's been locked since she passed away, and that's how it shall stay. Are you afraid of me?
A little.
Why?
It may have something to do with your face, sir. It's very hard.
Well, I cannot help my hard face. Continue with what you are playing. Go on, I have it all day. Are you going to play or not?
If you say, come with me off to Massachusetts, then to Massachusetts we will go. We will buy dishes there, maybe even 2 cents. Buy the finest china, then we'll dine a wall of grape Suzettes.
Well, go on.
We will build model boats off in Massachusetts, there in Massachusetts by the bay. Put them together and wait until the glue sets.
What's the matter now?
I don't remember the rest, sir.
While we wait, we'll poker for the folk along the parapet. To Massachusetts.
Yes, we're off.
To where the shops are sweet.
We will play minuets off in Massachusetts. Boston, Massachusetts, Beacon Street.
Stay
come
with me.
Come with me. Massachusetts, we will go.
We will
buy dishes there.
Yes.
Buy the finest china, then we'll dine a while our great Suzette's.
Yes, we're off
off to Massachusetts. Yes, we're off to where the shops are sweet. We will have no regrets off in Massachusetts.
Wonderful day.
It's wonderful.
We'll never forget.
getting to the station.
Amy, darling. Amy, Aunt March will be here soon.
You don't want to miss your train.
I'm going to need some more time. I have to wait for Joe. Tell me I'm doing the right thing.
You're doing the right thing.
I've never left my girls before.
Your husband needs you in Washington. He has pneumonia.
I feel like I'm being torn in two. One part of me here and the other part of me there.
I'm looking on the girls every day.
Thank you, Mr. Lawrence.
I'll just take this to the carriage. Good morning, Beth.
Good morning, sir. I fixed you a basket of food, Mommy.
Amy's almost ready. She's packing up half the house.
Do you know where Joe is? I sent her to Aunt March's hours ago. She should be back by now.
I can go find her.
Here's the shawl the father loves so much.
Marmy! 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 Don't make me go to Aunt March's house. It scares me. Oh, I have the picture for you. It's of you, with your flowers in your hair, and you're the goddess of spring. And it's for Father. Is he going to die?
No, Amy. I'll make sure he recovers. Now go get the rest of
your Mommy, Mommy! I'm sorry I'm late, but I did get the money.
Oh, Joe, I know how hard it is for you to ask Aunt March for money.
I didn't. I just couldn't, so I went to the town square and I tried telling my stories all morning. And when that failed, I pulled my hair.
You're bald.
I'm not bald.
Well, your hair was your best feature.
She looks beautiful.
Well, now Marmy will have enough money to go and stay with Father in Washington for as long as he needs her. Here, $27.25. I threw in a few coins that I've been stashing.
Joe, you shouldn't have. I'm so
disappointed.
Proud. It was a very courageous thing to do.
Oh, I love you.
Miss March, your carriage is here. Joe, you look different.
Mrs. March, we must be getting to the station.
I guarantee by next spring, every girl in Concord will be having
a... Lori,
come, let me hold my girls.
Oh, this is the first time we've ever been apart. I feel awful.
Amy.
I'll take care of everything, Mommy. Don't worry.
My dear Margaret, make certain your husband recovers.
Yes, Aunt March. And thank you for taking Amy. Amy, tell Aunt March how excited you are.
I'm so excited to be staying with you while Marmy's in Washington.
Oh, naturally.
No glum faces and no tears. I'll be back as soon as possible. How did you girls grow up so fast? Goodbye, Aunt March.
Oh, and you'll tell Father how much I miss him and love him and in the picture.
Josephine! What have you done?
I cut my hair so that Marmy could have a safe journey to Washington.
You did what? I told you, if you ever need money, you come to me!
I was hoping to earn my own money.
Cutting one's hair and selling it like a beggar is not an option for a lady. You look like a shorn sheep. Have you forgotten our contract?
Oh no, I never forget it. Traveling and seeing Europe and Paris and London.
If you don't live up to your end of the bargain, why should I live up to mine?
I tried living up to my part of the bargain. I went to a ball, I practiced dancing with men, I read books on etiquette. I held my tongue in several situations which I just wanted to scream out. I've got a fire in me, Aunt March.
Let us see how far this fire takes you in life. See what doors this fire will open. Let us see what society has to say about your fire.
To hell with society!
Josephine!
We don't live for society. We live to expand our minds, fulfill our dreams.
That is enough! And as for Europe, you can forget it. Europe is for someone with a little more understanding hang of its rewards.
No, I must, please, I didn't.
The subject is closed!
Subject is not closed. And even if it were, I'd open it back up again. I'll go to Europe. I will. I'll go to Europe if I have to swim there!
Yeah.
Hello, John!
I like your haircut, Joe.
And my hair will grow back!
And just who is this man?
He's Laurie's tutor and a friend.
Well, tell your friend his visit should be brief. Amy, collect your things. I'll be waiting for you in the carriage.
Yes. Why, Joseph?
I have plans for you.
Yes, Aunt March.
John, what have you done?
I've enlisted. I couldn't stand by any longer. Your own father's in the Army hospital in Washington. I have friends who will never come home.
When do you leave?
Tonight. Meg, Margaret, I'm not a rich man, and I'm not particularly handsome.
Oh, you're very handsome, John.
Really? You think so? I'm not the wisest man in the
you're
world.
You're very wise.
Thank you. Meg, Margaret.
If you could find it in your heart, if you could love me as I love you, if only you'll care when we are apart, then I would be rich, I would be wise, I would be more, more than I have.
Wait for your return, wait while you're at war.
If you will wait while I'm gone, if you'll imagine me here with you, if only you'll care if I carry on, then I could be strong.
Why must you go?
I could be brave.
Don't be too
I could be more.
Why come home?
More than I am. If you will say you love me enough to I will come home and love you.
Swear you'll come home.
Aunt March is waiting for you.
I'll come and visit you later.
Goodbye, everyone.
What about our promise to remain together?
We made that a long time ago, Joe. I've changed. You've changed.
I haven't changed. I would make a promise one day and then break it another.
I love him.
So you love him? We're talking about us, Meg. We're all that each other has anymore. Our future as a family is at stake.
Joe.
You can't turn your back on us.
I'm not turning my back on you.
I told you, I'm going to become a famous writer.
I know.
And I'll give you everything that you've ever dreamed of.
But if she loves him, Joe.
Oh, and I do, with all my heart and soul.
I've lost Meg.
You haven't lost Meg.
Well, I've lost my trip to Europe.
No, you haven't. You'll find your way there someday, Joe. I know you can. You can do anything. You can make the clouds disappear.
It's you who makes the clouds disappear.
Come with me and tell me about your day today.
Well, I sold my hair. Yes. And before that, I stood in the town common all morning and I cried out, Joe March is here! And then I started reciting my story.
Carlotta,
the mad woman in the attic.
The mad woman in the attic, a creature of gall, a spinster rejected by the world. Joe March. Her hair ghastly white and her eyes beady red. Joe, it's your best friend, Theodore Lawrence III. Reached a craggly hand out to the wretched knight.
Lori! Oh, Lori, Christopher, God love
it! It is so good to see you.
You have not been here in weeks.
I was in Boston. I have dreadful news.
What news?
With the war over, grandfather's insisted I get on with my life. He's enrolling me in school.
What?
I'm going to college in time for the summer session.
That's wonderful news.
What's wonderful about losing the best friend I ever had?
I can't imagine life in Concord without you. Not seeing that silly grin every day.
I don't want to go.
You've got to go. This is such an incredible opportunity, college! I'd go in a minute. I'd study everything.
What do you need of schools? You're going to be a famous writer.
Famous?
Can I tell you something?
Tell me something.
Ever since the first day we met, do you remember that day?
Of course.
The day you chopped down grandfather's cherished tree? I knew from that day on we'd be magnificent together.
We are magnificent together.
Joe, for weeks now, months, all year,
What was that?
A kiss?
Yes, I know it was a kiss!
It was my first kiss. I've thought about it for weeks.
What has gotten into you?
Look, I took part of my inheritance and I bought you this ring.
A ring? No, Lori, stop that. That is not funny.
I love you, Joe, and I want to marry you.
Marry me? No. No. No, go find somebody else. Go find some accomplished girl.
Don't want an accomplished girl. I want you.
Well, you can't have me.
At least say you'll think about it.
There's nothing to think about. I will never marry.
You will.
I won't.
You'll marry him. Just not me, that's what you're saying.
Lori, I thought you understood.
You knew how I felt, Joe. Everybody knew.
You knew all along who I am. What I wanted, I bared my soul to you, Lori. Go away!
Joe!
Please, just go! What was meant to be? How could he ruin it all? It was too worse.
did I miss? A kiss when I thought all along had a river meant to fort frontiers. How could I be so wrong? And I need, how I need my sisters here. If I can't share my dreams, what were they for? I thought our promise meant that we would never change and never part. Together we'd amaze the world. How can I live my dreams or even start when everything has come apart? I thought home was all I'd ever want. My attic, all I'd ever need. Now nothing feels the way it was before, and I don't know how to proceed. I only know I'm meant for something more. There must be somewhere I can be. Astonishing. I am meant to lead a life like nothing I have known, and I can feel it, and it's far from here. I've got to find it on my own.